because there's a bit of a delay.
Gentlemen, your attention, please. We will be closing the doors in about 2 minutes. Please take your seats. Thank you very much.
And one of the MCs and live stream. Live stream, keeping that going. So hopefully that works all good. Yeah. Should be fine. And they're recording everything for afterwards.
From Kenya to Colombia, from Iraq to Korea, in slums, in schools, in prisons, and in theatres. Every day, people gather at TEDx events around the world to hear the best ideas bubbling up in their communities. Today, you are part of a global conversation about our shared future. So what is this TEDx? TEDx is an initiative of the TED Conference, a nonprofit devoted to ideas worth spreading. We grant free licenses to allow TED-like events to spread globally. This event today is based on the TED Conference format and ideals, but is independently organized by your local community. So please make sure to thank the team of volunteers who worked so hard on today's event. It's their ideas, dedication, and time that made it all possible. It's they who booked all the speakers, and the views you'll hear today are, of course, those of those speakers, not necessarily of TEDs. We hope their talks spark an exciting conversation among you. This is a day for curiosity and for skepticism, for openness and for critical thinking, for inspiration and for action. The more you enter into it, the more you'll take out. And now, on with the show.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to TEDx Glasshouse Christian College here in the iconic Glasshouse Mountains region on Queensland's Sunshine Coast. If these mountains could speak, they would testify to a world that has undergone incredible and remarkable changes. Changes from the hunting and gathering of the Gubbi Gubbi people, to small pioneering farms, to the agriculture that we are more used to. From the timeless forest to our housing estates and the increasingly urban lifestyle now enjoyed by the majority of these inhabitants. Only a century ago, we had horse-drawn carts as the method of transport. Now we have cars that run on electricity and have the ability to drive themselves. We have ultra-powerful computers that you hold in the palm of your hand. We even have robots that allow filmmaking novices the ability to take footage like this through a drone flying off from a mountain and navigating its own way home. As the world of work and leisure will continue to be transformed in extraordinary ways by technology, it is clear that the world of education cannot stay still. The citizens of tomorrow will need to be equipped with the skills, the confidence, and a new way of knowing to thrive in this ever-changing and dynamic world. Join us as we seek to broaden our horizons and peer into what the classroom of the future may look like. Journey with us towards tomorrow.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Is it on? Good afternoon, staff, students, and invited guests. That was the voice of Mr. Mike Curtis, our principal, welcoming you to TEDx Glasshouse Christian College. My name is Josh Andrews. We believe that the insights that will be shared today will enrich your lives and encourage you to look into your own future to create a better world and a better life for all. However, before we begin, there are a few housekeeping matters that I would like to address. Firstly, we are recording and live streaming the footage of today online, and the talks will be available on the official TEDx YouTube channel within a few weeks. Secondly, please turn off all mobile phones and light emitting devices. That could interfere with the filming quality. Thirdly, please remain seated during the talks because the movement of the audience members during recording would prevent us from getting usable footage. Fourthly, toilet facilities are outside the theatre door to the right. Fifthly, In the unlikely event of an evacuation, you can follow the directions of the staff members to the oval through the two side doors. Sixthly, please join us for some refreshments during our intermission. All our guests will have their refreshments in the foyer area outside. Seventhly, in the event of technical difficulties, please bear with us as we retake to ensure the best possible footage. The moment has arrived to welcome our first speaker for the day, Rob Steffler. He is the Dean of Studies at Glasshouse Christian College, who has long had a passion for innovative curriculum. He drives several programs that seek to challenge and inspire students and staff to go beyond their current paradigms of what good education looks like. Join me in welcoming him to the TEDx stage.
Thank you, Josh, and I'm privileged to stand on this stage today and have the opportunity to speak to you. And I think more importantly, I'm privileged to share the stage with some amazing speakers. I hope and trust that we're going to be challenged in a number of ways by the talks that we hear over the next couple of hours. I've titled my talk, Back to the Future of Education. And if you thought there was a link between the 1980s movie series and the Year 10 program that I'm going to share with you today, you'd be absolutely correct. I've brought a prop with us today to help us get into the mood of Back to the Future and the DeLorean car. Essentially, what I want to share with you today is where this college has gone in its attempt to explore innovation in education and what the DeLorean represents in that sort of space. It really starts with inspiration, and inspiration leads to conviction. For me, this happened when I started at this school in 2014, and I felt a call to action to look at what education looked like, what the current system looked like, and whether we were doing justice to our students. Are we best preparing our students for the future that they're going to be exposed to over the next decade or so? So Ken Robinson, I think everyone would agree, who's an educator, is a fairly inspirational speaker. Pretty much anything he says, you leave with inspiration and encouragement to teach well and be the best teacher you can be. Alan November was someone who we got to spend a day with at the college last year. He's from the States, and he talks about students owning their learning. And he's really interested in students' learning and assessment being authentic. And Heidi Hayes Jacobs, who is probably the catalyst for the program that I have the privilege of sharing with you today, she asked the question, what year are you preparing your students for? And I would guess that if you told her next year, she would probably shake her head at you. You can watch all of these people on TED. They've all done TED Talks. And Astra Teller is another one I haven't had the privilege of seeing in person, but he's just done a TED Talk recently on celebrating failure, and it's well worth your time to watch that. If we could get our young people thinking the way his team at the Moonshot Factory, formerly known as Google X, think, then I think they'd be very set up for the future that they're going to face over the next 5, 10, 15 years. Essentially, I spent 12 months really looking at what an innovative curriculum could look like, and we were faced with a challenge at our school. And I did what most people do. I looked to others with more wisdom than me, and I met with a colleague and a mentor of mine from my previous school and said, what do you think we should do with what's presented to us? This is our programming challenge. This is our curriculum challenge. And essentially, he said, you have the opportunity to do something totally unique, completely different, and something that is absolutely one of a kind, if you were to choose to do so. And I basically took that as challenge accepted. And so I spent quite a bit of time planning and putting together a proposal for what we affectionately call the DeLorean Project. I went to the boss and I said, what do you think? This is a crazy idea. Let's push all our academic subjects to 4 days a week, and let's have students spend the fifth day in a space that they might not be particularly comfortable with. Let's provide some flexible opportunities where they actually drive the learning, where students actually make the decisions around the things that they're going to learn and the things that they're essentially going to teach themselves. And the key was that we wanted to focus on 21st century skills. I think our Australian curriculum does a really good job of defining those skills in what are called the general capabilities. I would propose today that maybe our current education system and the people who write curriculum don't give those general capabilities the credence and the respect that maybe they deserve. And I think our program is evidence of how important these skills are. Our students in Year 10 spend one day a week, and they're being challenged to collaborate, analyze, research, design, innovate, and communicate, and most importantly, contribute to a world bigger than themselves and the immediate school community. We had to come up with a framework to talk about these skills, and so we used University of Melbourne's framework for 21st century learning. And it's great because it's color-coded so we can speak in colors. It's simple and it just provides a great go-to framework for our students and the facilitators of the program to be able to communicate with each other. We had to get the timetable right, and we had to get the person in charge of curriculum to give it the approval. That was a fairly quick conversation. It was a good one too, because it was a conversation with myself. I just happened to be the person who does those things. And so I very quickly approved of something like this, and we, with the principal's approval, were ready to go. The only thing we didn't have was a name. I spent hours translating words like innovation and creativity and design and critical thinking into Latin and Greek and all sorts of languages to see if we could find a word to encapsulate this program, and I had no luck. And it was through a passing joke in the staff room at the end of 2015 where I said to a colleague that I'd asked to be on the team for this program, when it was in the news that Marty McFly in the second movie of Back to the Future had traveled to 2015, I said to her, maybe we should just name it after the crazy scientist in his time machine. And she looked at me and I looked at her, and there was this exciting moment of silence, and we knew we'd actually stumbled across the name of our program, and the DeLorean Project was born. We had to come up with a way to talk about the projects and the ideas that these students would create and drive with the students themselves, so they knew that they were on track. And so we created, as a team, the DeLorean Spheres. And every project that is running in Year 10 in 2016 has to meet each of these spheres. Any students who have an idea that they want to pursue, they have to show that there's a problem out there that they're trying to solve. They have to have show that they're going to have an entrepreneurial mindset to solve these problems. And I would say, based on the work we've done this year and the research that I've done, if we can get more students thinking with an entrepreneurial mindset, they're going to be so much better prepared for the future that they're going to face in the next decade or so. And lastly, we wanted them to use technologies and prove that they could leverage their project and their learning through the use of technologies. And so this was a constant go-to framework for us in our conversations with students. Now, the thing we had to do on the first day of school, because the first day of school in 2016 just happened to be the day of the DeLorean Project on a Wednesday, we had to create a bit of a story. And we found different ways to do that, but one of the ways that we thought we could create a bit of a narrative with our students is to actually see if we could get a DeLorean. And we did. We brought it. There's a guy who owns a DeLorean in our local community, and he was willing to bring it in. And it's kitted out with a flux capacitor and a hoverboard, and you'll see Emmett Brown's Einstein dog in the back seat. And it was just a great way to engage kids in this idea and start talking about the analogy of a mad scientist who, in the face of all sorts of challenges, persevered and was able to travel through time, not just once, but multiple times across the three-movie trilogy. We also realized that students weren't necessarily going to be comfortable in this space. We realized that the skills we were asking them to spend a whole day working on, they might not be particularly great at, because most of our traditional education doesn't address these skills that well. And so we spent a lot of time right at the beginning of the program working with them in low-risk activities, talking about collaboration, communication, how to work as a team, and really trying to just give them an opportunity to take some risks, fail in a lot of senses, and learn from those risks, so that when we got to the idea generation towards the end of the first part of our semester in 2016, they were able to speak about these ideas and know where they were headed with what their ideas might look like. And as we got to the end of this first part of the program, we realized that these kids had some great ideas. And it was almost scary because as facilitators, we were going, how do we make these happen? But that's part of the learning journey that we were on. To give you a quick overview, because I don't have a lot of time, so I'm trying to pack a year's worth of experience into 18 minutes. We have 90 Year 10 students in 2016 of varying abilities, interests, and passions. And let me just say, one of the main things about this program was that students were encouraged to follow their interests and passions. And what we found is that if they don't, then success is a lot harder to achieve. We have seven passionate DeLorean Project facilitators, DPFs we like to call them. They're teachers, but they don't teach the way that you would think teachers should teach in this program. We have 25 projects running, from social justice projects to business startups to three projects I can't easily categorize. And finally, six projects that are science-focused that come from a partnership we have with the University of the Sunshine Coast. We're looking at over 200 curriculum hours in the year that we've spent on this program. And one of the poignant experiences we had was an event that we called the DeLorean Shark Tank, where students had done a lot of idea generation and really, we challenged them to think big, and then what we said is, now you've got to pitch this to five sharks, entrepreneurs and business people in the community. And those sharks were very honest about the ideas that they saw pitched. So for some students, the feedback was really hard to hear. In fact, some groups dissolved after that because of that feedback. Other groups heard some feedback that maybe wasn't particularly positive, and they just had perseverance to carry on. And other groups got great feedback. We actually had two groups approached after the Shark Tank where sharks offered further support in a number of ways. And currently we're now working towards our final event of the year, which we've called D-Day, our DeLorean Project Showcase in mid-November, where students are challenged to share their experience. One of the things we very clearly say is it's not about the end product, it's actually about the process that these students have been through and the experiences they've had along the way that we're challenging them to share with us. And then, of course, there's countless stories of every project. I can tell you 25 different stories, and all of them are stories of success in some way or another. But I've got to pick a couple. And so I'd like you to meet the USC DeLorean team, and you're actually going to hear from four of these students. I, again, took a bit of a risk with going out, and I had a relationship with Dr. Adam Polkinghorne at the University of the Sunshine Coast, and I asked for an hour of his time, and I sat down and I just gave it a shot, and I said, this might sound crazy, but what do you reckon about some Year 10s having the opportunity to do some real life learning at the university? And he didn't say no. In fact, he was quite excited about the idea, and through a lot of work and effort, we now have seven students spending their Wednesdays working on real research at the University of the Sunshine Coast at Adams Animal Research Center. Each of them are being mentored one-on-one by one of Adams' PhD students, and as you can imagine, the learning that they would do would be absolutely phenomenal, and an experience that I would suggest many Year 10 students don't get. I don't know that there's another program or partnership like it in the state or even the country, although I won't. I don't know that for sure, but I'd risk saying that. It's very unique. And we're really excited to continue that in 2017 and beyond. This is PantryMate. PantryMate formed early on. They've stuck together the whole way, but they had a big idea. And it was actually Sophie in the bottom right-hand corner there that realized that all of the interests and passions the group were sharing came down to two things, food and technology. And they came up with the idea of and the challenge of whether they could create a smart pantry. A pantry that will talk to your phone and essentially mean you'll never run out of food. Your shopping list could be created automatically, and you'll never ask the question when you're in the shops whether you need something, because you'll know it. They've been through two prototypes, which you can see there. That wasn't a prototype, that's Caitlin. And I've just been told today that they've just finished their third prototype. They've found funding externally for some of the cost of these prototypes, which is really exciting. And they've worked through a lot of challenge. For a long time, they didn't get anywhere. They said the hardest thing they've had to do is work as a team. And aside from that, it was just not getting anywhere and having the tenacity to continue with the idea. They're planning on taking it into next year. They're planning on coming in on Wednesdays and working on Wednesdays on this project, which is, for me, amazing, because the cohort coming through in 2017 is going to see firsthand the fruits of hard work from the cohort who has been. So it's potentially a very much a legacy project that will continue for time to come. This is Caitlin, and I want to talk about two more students, Caitlin and Jay. And the reason I want to talk about them is because they basically are a good example of us making a really big mistake. Both Caitlin and Jade, and believe me, we made a lot of mistakes. Both Caitlin and Jade were told no, something that I would really have not liked to do, but they were told no for a couple of reasons. Caitlin was told no for two reasons. One, she wanted to work as an individual, and two, she wanted to speak to middle school students about anxiety and depression around the local community. And we said one, working as an individual doesn't allow you to collaborate. And two, there's no way that someone's going to let a U10 student in to talk about something like that with young people. And so we said no. One of the things we've asked students to do with this project, though, is to be really honest and be really honest about that vocally. And so Caitlin came to me at the end of the first term when she'd been told no, and she said, the saddest thing for me is that you didn't give me a chance to prove myself. And we had to reflect on that and go, you know what? You're right, we didn't. So we actually came back into term two and we said, okay, here's your chance. Now this photo I've cut, this photo was taken a couple of weeks ago. I've cut it off because the rest of the photo shows Caitlin's success. It was taken on her way to speak to 90 year eight students at a state high school in Kiwanis in our local community. As of today, she's spoken to over 300 middle school students about anxiety and depression. She collaborates with at least two qualified psychologists to make sure that her content is not only valuable, but it's correct. So on all facets, she proved us wrong. She's received a public apology from me on numerous occasions, which I'm sure she's very excited and happy about. And it's just a great example of being flexible to give students the ability to show that they can achieve something when most adults would think it's not possible. There's her speaking to some students. Jade is another one of our beloved DeLorean students who is not backwards about coming forwards. And we love that about Jade. She will tell us how it is. And that's exactly what she did when she started the DeLorean project. Jade was not happy about this idea. And so rather than me tell you about it, I want Jade to tell you herself. And I've done a quick interview with Jade. So she's going to tell us about her DeLorean experience when it started this year.
I didn't really like the idea of it because I was like, just forcing us to do something that we're not really passionate about or that isn't going to be successful. Because I didn't think it would work, because I was like, we're only like 14 and 15 year olds, and it's not going to work. And it's just a waste of a Wednesday. I really thought we should just do another subject and kind of have another fun year in a sense. And so the first semester of doing a project that I really wasn't passionate about was, yeah, pretty boring. I didn't really enjoy it at all. I was really just wanting Wednesday to be over and the year to be over.
Now, at this point, it's probably worth mentioning that Jade is the principal's daughter. And I don't know about you, but if you're trying to create a new program that's innovative and different, it would be kind of nice if the principal's daughter was on board so that when she went home and talked about it, the principal was hearing good things. However, this was reality for us. We wanted honesty, and so Jade was honest with us. Now, she was also very mature in her responses, and she worked with us. And I'm very happy to say that today, things are very different for Jade. But again, I'd like her to share that with you. So she's going to do that now.
After the Shark Tank experience, and I left the group that I was in, that I wasn't really passionate about at all, and I sat down and I was like, if I'm going to make this worthwhile, I've got to do something that I'm really passionate about. So I went into the Shark Tank thing with my idea that I was passionate about and to see their thoughts, because I wasn't 100% on it, but I just wanted to see if it could be something. And they told me it couldn't be anything, but they loved my passion for it. So I created a website where I put up a bunch of blogs and I do like religion ethics or Sunday school lessons that are available for purchase. I've just received thousands of views and gotten like, I think it's, I actually know how many thousand, but there's a lot of like subscribers and views and stuff, and it became a like popular thing and people were becoming more interested, and I kept on getting feedback. I have six different mentors. From a couple of them are in Western Australia, so that means like I Skype and I email a lot with them. And then I've got two in Brisbane and one with the school and one with my church. And so I just talk to them a bunch and I get them to look at all my work. And I was sitting there with my blog and I was like, how, if I'm gonna build this, I need to like find someone that is in the industry in a sense. And I was like, but who's in this industry? And I'm like, oh, hey, I love waking up and reading YouVersion. And I'm like, why don't I just try and get in contact with them? YouVersion is an online Bible app which goes and they do trackers and they have full different versions of the Bible. And they were like, hey, we read some of your blogs and we actually think you're really keen. And they didn't know I was a Year 10 student at all. And they were like, yep, we're happy to sponsor you. And we can see that you're on like a free account on WordPress, which is like where I started my website. They're like, we're really happy to be paying the $14 like a month or a week or something like that. In a sense, if you give us some advertisement back, we're happy to sponsor you and to give you some of our like people. So it's like, that's where I've got two mentors from YouVersion. I never knew that something like Sunday school or RE and, you know, a Christian blog that I'm passionate about, I really didn't think it would be successful in the beginning. And it is. I am, so that's awesome.
Now, Jade is being very humble about her stats. I can tell you about her stats. She has had over 9,000 views on myperspective.co. She's had 1,700 subscribers, email subscribers. She's had sponsorship, as we heard, multiple members in this nation and in America. She's being published externally, which is really exciting. One of her blogs is being published. And she's made to date just over $450 selling educational, religious education resources, Sunday school lessons, and that's all gone to Compassion Australia, which is, the epitome of real contribution in our eyes. And interestingly enough, some of these students at a high school in the United States, Oceana High School in California, emailed her and asked if they could create some posters about her website, and so she's now getting some notoriety in a high school in California and starting to get subscribers through people promoting her work. So. For us, a huge win, and for Jade, something that I don't think she ever expected out of a project that she at first really didn't see the value of. Her final quote, I wanted to quote it, and I did, but I also ended up being able to get her to give us her version of it in an interview. So if we can just have a look at that final quote.
The year almost to be over, not so much that I get out of DeLorean like I thought at the beginning, but so that the project's my project.
Now for us as program facilitators, that's about as good as it gets, where students want to continue their work not because it's a project or a program at school, but because they value it and they see value in continuing it. So Jade, thank you for letting me share your story and being honest with us, because it's made our program much more, I think, valuable in itself. Morphing educational mindsets. I can honestly say that the last 12 months for me has been the most transformative months of my almost 15-year career by far. It's taught me a lot about teaching and what I thought teaching was and what it isn't and maybe what it should be. We've found out very clearly that students are not comfortable in this sort of context. They don't understand yet that failure is good, that risk-taking is good, and that roadblocks are good. That's been a real challenge. And so we need to start to cultivate the grit and the tenacity that's required to overcome roadblocks and endure failure, because we know that failure leads to success. I've learned that learning should be way messier than I thought it would, than I thought it needs to be. It should be adaptable and open to change. This program is the epitome of the process being far more valuable than the product. And it's taught me that teaching in a silo is just not where we should be. And so I've called it out of the silo and onto the stage. I've had the privilege of teaching in front of six other passionate staff members at the college. And my strengths I'm able to use, but when my weaknesses are apparent, and there are many, my colleagues stand up and take over, and we're able to partner and teach on a whole new level that traditionally we just don't do. So to me, this should happen more often as it can. It's okay not to know the answers. I don't know most of the answers to most of the questions that these students ask. So it's the idea that the teacher is the font of all knowledge is absolutely untrue in my opinion. And the most exciting thing for me is that those general capabilities, those 21st century skills, it's shown us how important they are. And what's exciting is that based on our experience in the DeLorean project is that we're now exploring what we're doing in traditional subjects in our other curriculum to leverage these skills and make ourselves relevant to the students that we're going to be teaching. I want to finish with a quote from Winston Churchill. I admire and respect those speakers that I talked about at the beginning of my presentation. I think they're amazing people who inspire a whole lot of teachers and professionals around the world. But sometimes you leave a speaker like that and you don't necessarily get the practical tools to do anything about that inspiration. And so I guess my encouragement in talking to you today is that we should be sharing these stories, that we should be willing to take risks, especially if we're educators in positions of leadership. I think we owe it to our students and to preparing them for the future to take those risks and be open to changing the way that we do education. I don't think anyone would disagree that Winston Churchill got things done. He said, well done is better than well said. I encourage people to be well doers once they've heard the well sayers. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Steffler. I'm sure you have given us all a new perspective on what education could look like in the future. Part of the aim of TEDx is to introduce ideas that can change the world. Our next speaker is a person who has experienced exactly what Mr. Steffler was just talking about. Please welcome Daniel Mitchell to the stage for the first of four of our micro-talks.
Good evening. My name is Dan Mitchell, and for the past 8 months, I've been participating in a project led by the University of the Sunshine Coast that has been implemented to provide an insight into future jobs, career options, and opportunities for today's youth. I've had the privilege to be working with Elise Taylor-Brown, who is currently completing her PhD at the university. I've been assisting her with a PhD project on the well-known disease, chlamydia. So outside the chlamydia that infect humans, there are a range of other chlamydial pathogens that are associated with disease in animals, several of which, the ones that I've been working with, infect fish. Chlamydia pathogens have been described in over 90 fish species, both fresh and saltwater. Some of the more common species affected include bass, yellowtail kingfish, barramundi, salmon, and trout. The chlamydia reside in the gills of the fish and cause enlargement of the gill epithelial cells, which makes breathing extremely difficult, and in most cases leads to fatality. This poses a major problem in both aquaculture and natural ecosystems concerning the balance of the ecosystem and the economics of the fish industry. With this project, I've been able to contribute to the knowledge and understanding of these chlamydial pathogens, as well as their range of hosts. So you might recognize some of these common fish products and meals. Well, these here are the real deal. These are the beautiful fish that I've been working with over the span of our project. The two on the side are southern bluefin tuna, and the one in the middle is a cobia. These are both local Australian fish, which provide amazing recreational fishing, as well as farm production. Now these beautiful fish are in danger of chlamydial infection, and it is so important that they are saved. For the project, we obtained our fish samples from local aquacultural farms and screened them for chlamydia by extracting the DNA from the gills and detecting a fragment of the chlamydial gene. We established that the southern bluefin tuna samples were negative for chlamydial, however, the cobia were positive. So what were we able to do with this information? We've been able to impact the community, impact the local community by establishing the pathogen affecting the local aquacultural farm so they can put in place methods to prevent mortality of their produce. And hopefully this project will influence the gradual discovery and prevention of disease, not only in fish species, but every chlamydial host, including humans. Overall, this project was a huge learning curve, and it made me start thinking seriously about my future career options. It provided me with an important insight into a real science career, a taste of life outside of school, and has given me inspiration and passion for my future. I believe this was a great project, and I highly recommend that other schools begin implementing projects similar to ours. Thank you.
How fascinating. Thank you, Daniel. It is now my privilege to introduce someone who has issues of social justice very close to her heart. She is actively involved in promoting social cohesion and reaching out to those in need. Please welcome our school captain, Wale James.
If you don't connect with someone, you might send them a text and say, hey, you want to go out for coffee? Or do you want to get a beer later tonight? And maybe some of you even say, would you like to come over for morning tea? Tea plays a significant role in various cultures. It is used at both formal and social events. As you can see here, there are three very different teapots. Tonight, they represent three diverse cultures: Aboriginal Australian, Western cultures, and Japanese. Each of these pots are different in shape and size. They've been created differently, they boil different types of tea leaves, and brew different tastes. But at the end of this process, we still find ourselves holding a cup of tea. Tea is kind of like us, I guess you could say. We have different worldviews. We have different upbringings, different cultures, and different opinions. But just like with a teapot, we are all still human. We're all trying to coexist, and we're all trying to find the perfect brew. Did you know that there are over 3,000 varieties of tea? Taking this into consideration, we can safely assume these 3,000 varieties all taste different. And it's fair to say not everyone is going to like the same tea. This is very similar to our world, which has a variety of rich cultures. But we live in a world literally battling to accept difference, our own differences and those who are different to us. Civil wars, ethnic cleansing, racism, genocide, and stereotypes. Unfortunately, our history is testament to our inability to accept those who are different to us. And sometimes our differences can clash, and we can find it difficult to maintain friendships. If we look at this problem on a wide scale of things, if we refuse to create these friendships, then our future will continue to repeat our past. But I have the solution. And the solution lies within three diverse teapots. Perhaps if we took the time to share three cups of tea with someone, we could get to know them a little bit better and maybe even prevent the past from repeating itself. So let's create a tea drinking revolution. This will create friendships that unify us, not segregate us. And this can work if we can understand and apply the idea that three cups of tea can create the framework for a unified future. I'd like you all to think about your first cup of tea with someone. This is your first introduction. What's your name? Where do you come from? What do you do for work? And it's a little bit awkward. I mean, we shake hands and we might sit in silence and we make a little bit of small talk. And we probably use this time to carefully observe one another, but we're probably pretty shy, so we probably spend most of our time looking at our teacups. Our accents and appearance may be a bit different, and we will need to listen carefully to what each other is saying. But it's okay if we ask each other to repeat ourselves once or twice. This is the time where we need to get used to the tune of each other's voices. And maybe we might reveal one thing about ourselves. And then you have your second cup of tea. We now start this cup of tea knowing just a little about each other. We invite them to sit down, and we may pass each other a smile across our teacups. We know how you like your tea, and we're more friendly with each other. Our accents are being heard better. The tunes of our voices are becoming familiar. We may not discuss the deep stuff yet, but we are slowly drinking our way there. And then finally comes our third cup of tea. We start this cup of tea knowing even more about each other. When we see each other, we embrace. Oh, it's so good to see you. How have you been? And we know how the other person likes their tea, like the palm of our hand. And we know about their family. And we spend time together laughing and sharing stories. And now our accents are easily understood. We know the tunes of each other's voices, and we are relaxed in this atmosphere. Three cups of tea. That's all it could take to unite the nations. But although we can drink tea, and although we can spend time creating friendships, there are some things we need to consider while doing this. I guess you could say it's kind of like the milk and sugar we put in our tea. It's to make the experience a little more pleasurable. Just as we drank three cups of tea, there are three steps. And the first step is to observe. When you enter this space, I want you to enter it with an open mind. Don't judge the differences you are about to encounter, but look at them with an open and caring heart. Expect the person you meet to be a little bit different to you, but you will also be different to them. And maybe at first this difference will be difficult to understand, but do not fear what you don't understand. Observe with willing eyes. Find your similarities and take the time to learn about each other's differences. The second step is to listen. Take the time to share and listen to your experiences with each other. This time of listening and sharing is a crucial step in developing an awareness of differences. But I want you to remember something. You are not the master when it comes to another person's difference. They are the masters of their own difference. They know who they are and where they come from. You don't, yet. And in fact, you may be pleasantly surprised with the story you hear. It may not be too dissimilar to your own. And then comes our last step, which is to interact gently and respectfully. Ask each other questions. Make compromises about what is appropriate in your friendship and what is not appropriate. Keep the space around the teacup safe, with no judgment. Speak with a neutral tone, and perhaps you might even review your own point of view. But remember, the objective of this interaction is to get to know each other. It's not to take on each other's beliefs. It's about sharing stories. And you know, some of us, we might need more than three cups of tea. And it might not even be tea, it could be something completely different. I promise you, the end result of this entire interaction is more than just a full bladder. It is a deeper understanding of someone. It's an opportunity to understand yourself a little better, to learn each other's stories, but find yourself at the beginning of a beautiful new friendship. It only takes three cups of tea to unite the nations. Tea is made all around the globe. It has different tastes. It is brewed differently, poured differently, presented in different styles. But it's still a cup of tea. We are all like tea. We have different upbringings, different cultures, different opinions, different worldviews. But we're all still human. We're all trying to coexist. We're all trying to find the perfect brew. And so I have one question for you. Who are you going to have 3 cups of tea with? Thank you very much.
What an amazing talk. I'm sure that is something that could make the world a much better place to live. Thank you, Mwale. It is now time for a bit of relaxation with some authentic sounds from a young local artist who has recently won the People's Choice Award at a competition on the Sunshine Coast. Ladies and gentlemen, Julian Munyard.
Okay, cool. Hey guys, this is a song I wrote, and it's just about striving for your goals and not letting what other people say hold you back. There it is. Until you get to the top, 'cause when the music plays, you'll be in the game. People worry about the next generation. Computers and phones is their occupation. So don't get caught up in what these people say. When the bell rings and the game is over, you got nothing to get you when you fall over. So don't get caught up in what these people say. Your boat, but don't be fooled for a lie. When the tide comes in, you got nowhere to go. Solution to your problem is to let it all go. So don't get caught up in what these people say. 'Cause when the bell rings and the game is over, you got nothing to get you when you fall. So don't get caught up in what these people say. Doing the same thing. We hop and we skip and we're rolling the pace. But people are so optimistic. You can't do that, don't go with the statistic. So don't get caught up in what these people say. When the bell rings and the game is over, you got nothing to get you when you fall. So don't get caught up in what these people say. What your heart says, don't get caught up in what those people say. 'Cause on that rainy day when things go bad, glad for the choices that you made. Oh.
Cutting-edge research for the University of the Sunshine Coast as our second micro-talk.
Please welcome Aaron Lurch and Joshua Kumi to the TEDx stage.
Hello everyone. Can anyone guess what our favourite Australian animal is?
Platypus.
Yep, that's right, it's a koala. And this animal we'll be discussing tonight. Now I know the koala is often referred to as a koala bear, however, it is not a bear at all. It is in fact a marsupial, meaning it gives birth to live young and has a pouch. This animal lived... This animal sleeps most of the time, only waking for a couple of hours per day to eat eucalyptus or gum leaves. These gum leaves are the koala's sole source of nutrition and main source of moisture, as they hardly ever, sometimes never, drink water.
Despite this creature's non-aggressive behaviour, it is fighting for its life. It's under attack by a killer smaller than the eye can see, the deadly bacteria Chlamydia picora. This bacteria attacks the urogenital and ocular regions of the animal, leading to conjunctivitis, blindness, and infertility, and often resulting in death.
It seems unfair that such a cute and harmless creature has to suffer like this, and many efforts are being made to prevent the koala from becoming infected.
I'm Aaron Lurch, and this is my friend Joshua Creamy, and together we are part of one of these efforts to protect the koala. We've been assisting PhD candidate Delaney Bernard at the University of the Sunshine Coast in research focused on the prevention of the transmission of Chlamydia picorum to koalas. Now everyone knows what a tick is, right? They're the horrible blood-sucking creatures that feed on animals and even humans.
Since a koala is a host for a wide range of tick species, and ticks are known to transmit diseases such as Rocky Mountain Fever and Lyme disease, it was thought that perhaps these ticks could be transmitting Chlamydia picorum to the koalas.
Over the past 8 months, we've screened hundreds of ticks for this bacteria, but although similar bacteria was found, the sinister Chlamydia picorum was not in sight.
Now, we may not have found the transmitter of the deadly Chlamydia picorum, but at least we have all but eliminated the suspect in the tick.
To put this all into perspective, we are both in grade 10 and aged 14 and 15, and have already made a small but important step towards the preservation of a national icon in the koala.
This journey has been an amazing learning experience, and if we could go back, we'll do it all again. Over the course of this year, we have gained insight into real-life jobs in the field of science, and have newfound knowledge, which will stay with us for the rest of our lives. In addition, we've had the privilege of working with Delaney, who is conducting amazing research in a bid to protect koalas from chlamydia.
I recommend that if you're a young person who wants to make a difference and gain a wealth of knowledge, that you ask your school or speak to a university and see if they could possibly organise a project like ours. Trust me, it's 100% worth it.
Thank you for your time.
Thanks to Clifton and saving the koala. Thank you, Aaron and Joshua. Our third micro-talk will be delivered by Lauren Paul. She will be sharing about her research with the University of the Sunshine Coast and about an animal that isn't quite as cuddly, but still has a lot of character. Please welcome her to the TEDx stage.
Good evening, my name is Lauren Poole, and this year I had the privilege of being one of seven students chosen from our Year 10 cohort to be mentored by a PhD student on one of seven animal healthcare projects offered at the University of the Sunshine Coast. An opportunity I, as with many others, have not encountered in the past. I was enthusiastic to be given this offer. Not only have our projects given us valuable insight into the field of science, but the opportunity to contribute to authentic scientific problem solving and inquiry. My project in particular delves into the understanding of animal personality, the social personality of individual eastern water dragons, to be specific. Interestingly enough, others involved in the project got to work with the cute and cuddly creatures of the world. I, on the other hand, had what I could say was the privilege of working with the Eastern Water Dragons. At this stage, some of you may wonder what Eastern Water Dragons are. This is what they look like. They are tree-dwelling lizards that are part of the iguana family and are native to Eastern Australia. They're 80 to 90 centimetres long, majority of which is their tail, that is flat on either side to assist with swimming. This one in particular caught my eye, as he is rather peculiar. From Judy to Francine, Loki and Delilah, you name it, we had it. One may also wonder, why use lizards? There's a common notion that lizards would not display distinctive behavior, but it is much the opposite. Eastern water dragons are highly gregarious creatures and display great amounts of variation in their behavior. Who would have thought that an Eastern water dragon would be so behaviorally diverse, exhibiting behaviors such as submissiveness and aggression? Testing these behaviors requires a variety of data collection methods that help us understand why animals are social and why we see so much variation in their social behavior. This is exactly what I did during the course of my project, and all with the guidance of my wonderful mentor, Carter Strickland. This is a prime example of knowledge is power. Some of the greatest scientific discoveries throughout history have been derived from a question driven by the power of curiosity. For instance, Charles Darwin's theories on natural selection came from asking questions. Questions that had the capacity to change science as we know it today, and to inspire generations onwards. Knowledge provides us with understanding that gives us the capacity to do more. I initially went on this endeavor through my interest in behavior and came out of this with this understanding and much more. This project has given me the incentive to ask these kinds of questions and be proactive on finding an answer, as well as showing me my capacity as an adolescent. As my mentor once said, science is everything. Science is medicine, it is technology, it is understanding how things function. In a society where the science industry is booming and today's youth is tomorrow's future, there is a lack of opportunities given to experience the power of science. I would highly suggest programs much like this to be implemented in schools, as the opportunity was priceless. Thank you.
Thank you for those insights, Lauren. It is my great privilege to introduce another entertainer with an exceptional musical talent. Please welcome Madeline Ralston on her harp. Thank you.
How incredible was that? Thank you, Madeline. Our fourth and final micro talk will be delivered by Keely Thomas. Keely has recently worked in collaboration with the University of the Sunshine Coast to study a threat to one of our other famous Australian animals. Please welcome her to the TEDx stage.
Hi, I'm Keely, and as you can probably tell by my accent, I'm Australian. As an Australian, I personally love native animals. Australia is known for some of the most iconic, cute, fluffy, and sometimes even deadly native animals. Some that instantly come to mind are the koala, the kangaroo, the Tasmanian devil, the platypus, the kookaburra, and some of the most deadly snakes and spiders around the world. But there's always one that sort of goes under the radar. It sort of slips everyone's mind. It looks somewhat like a little bear. It's the wombat. It eats mainly grass and roots. It lives in burrows under the ground. Something that's quite unique and funny about them is they have square-shaped poop. They're born hairless, which is adorable, and live in their mother's pouch. Now, the oldest and largest wombat in captivity is Patrick, who is 30 years old and lives at Ballarat Wildlife Park. Now, you might be wondering what's so important about wombats. Well, there are three species of wombats in Australia. The northern hairy nose, which lives in Queensland, the southern hairy nose, which is found mainly in South Australia, and the bear-nosed wombat, which was formerly known as the common wombat. And it spreads across New South Wales, Victoria, and Tasmania. Now, all three of these species have suffered population decline over the years due to hunting, dog attacks, urban development, and disease. One disease in particular would be sarcoptic mange, which affects two of the three species. It affects the bear-nosed wombat and the southern hairy-nosed wombat, which is probably a good thing because what causes the mange is a mite. And if it found its way into the small population of northern hairy-nosed wombats that are left, the species would probably be wiped out. So, Sarcoptes scabia is the name of the mite, and it infests over 104 mammals worldwide. This includes dogs, livestock, important wildlife, and even humans. In humans, it's called scabies. So what happens is the mite buries into the wombat's skin and causes the skin to get all scabby and crusted and grows over the eyes and the ears of the wombat, which basically leaves the wombat defenseless. The wombat then scratches, which causes secondary infections, for example, blood poisoning, and inevitably the animal dies. It is very hard to treat this because there is no vaccine. There is a topical ointment, however, it is very hard to treat an entire species with this because the mite is transferred via contact. So it is thought to be brought in by European settlers. However, there is there's limited in-depth research supporting this. It is becoming a very serious problem with localized extinction. So without the DeLorean project, I probably wouldn't have had the freedom and opportunity to work with so many amazing scientists at the University of the Sunshine Coast. One in particular would be Tamika Fraser, who was my supervisor. Together we worked through samples of mites ranging from wombats that were healthy and super mangy, and we identified the number of mites associated with the disease. What we found is that the process used to take these samples was not 100% effective, which means that early diagnosis and possibly treatment is lost. This is a real world project, and I am so proud and honoured to be part of this. It is not every day a 15-year-old can say that she's identified mites down in the microscope, conducted DNA extractions, and understands DNA sequencing for a real-world problem. It is our job, it is our responsibility to look after these beautiful creatures, and at the moment we're actually doing a pretty horrible job. These creatures are looking at the possibility that being extinct in 100 years. So we can't study them, we can't look at them. We don't need a repeat of the Tasmanian tiger or anything else that has gone extinct for that matter. This has been a truly enlightening and eye-opening experience, and I wouldn't change it for the world. It may not be the traditional educational system, but I have learned so much about mange and the skills I have gained, something that you wouldn't learn in school. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Keely. What an amazing privilege it is for young people to be exposed to practical science that actually makes a difference. It is time for our intermission now. There are some arrangements that we would like to let you know about. Toilet facilities are outside the theatre door to the right, and there are some more over the other side of the undercover area. Please join us for some refreshments during our intermission. All our guests will have their refreshments in the foyer area outside. There will be some tables at the entrance of the theatre to create some more space. Please be back and seated within 20 minutes so that we can finish on time. There will be a bell that rings 5 minutes prior to coming in so that we are able to do that. Thank you very much.